Hi everybody, this is Dr. A in our first video of the quality series, Quality in the Lab. We are going to look at basic statistics. Okay, so the basic statistics to understand quality and quality in the lab are going to be first the measures of center. So that is the mean, median, and mode. So the mean is the average of a group of numbers. The median is the middle value of a body of data, and to get the median, you have to put the data in order, right, from smallest to largest, and then it's the middle value. And if it's an even number of values, then it's actually the number that would be in the middle of the two middle numbers. So if it's like the two middle numbers on 9 and 10, then it would be 9.5. Okay. The mode is the value that is the most frequently occurring in a list of numbers, so that you would use to get the average or the mean. That list of numbers, if they are certain numbers that are repeating, the ones that repeat the most is the mode. And it can be, sometimes it can be bimodal. You can have a couple of modes within a set of data. So the mean is used the most, and we use it, to get the average of a group of numbers, and we use it to analyze data. But we don't use it by itself. We also use the measure of spread. So the distribution of all values around the average, around the mean, for a particular group of data is described statistically by the standard deviation. So the standard deviation is a measure of the variability in a data set. And that means that if you plot the points, if you plot them together, the variability is how close to the mean or how far from the mean or their spread. So are they really tight around the mean or are they really spread around the mean? Another measure of spread is going to be the coefficient of variation, and it simplifies comparing standard deviations. And so the lower the percentage of the coefficient of variation, the more precise the analyzer or method is. So the CV in percent is calculated by taking the standard deviation, dividing it by the mean, and then that times 100 gives you the CV in percent. The CV normalizes the variability of data by calculating the standard deviation as a percent of the mean, and it's easier to compare and to get cutoffs. So in chemistry, you want to keep your CVs below 3%, definitely below 5%, and so the lower the CV, again, the more precise that method or analyzer is. And then there's measure of shape. So it measures the distribution around the mean. A Gaussian distribution is a distribution in which the mean, median, and mode are all identical, and the distribution is symmetrical around the mean. And the way this is portrayed is you would have the mean is here in the middle, portraying where you have the most points here. 68% of the points are going to fall within this area, and that is within one standard deviation below or above the mean. And then the 95% of the data is going to fall between these two lines and in this area, and that is going to be two standard deviations below and above the mean. And then 99% of the data is going to fall within three standard deviations above and below the mean. This curve can take different shapes. If the CV is high and the standard deviations are larger, that means that it's more distributed around the mean. That means that this curve right here will be just wider. And if it's very precise and the CV is low and the data is really clustered around the mean, this curve could be a little taller and tighter, like that. And so that's just distribution, and we're going to apply this in a little bit to quality control. Some other basic statistics to look at is how we determine ranges, whether that is a reference range or a quality control range. We use the 95% confidence interval. So the reference range is always expressed as 95% confidence interval or the mean plus or minus two standard deviations. So as long as all the data falls here in that 95% confidence interval around the mean, then we're confident that if we say that that is the normal range for a value, a specific test in the lab, let's say glucose, we say the normal range is 80 to 100, then we're confident that if we draw blood from 100 people that are considered normal, 95 of them will fall exactly between 80 and 100, and 5% of them could fall slightly above or slightly below, even though they are considered normal. So statistically, the reference range for a particular measurement in most cases is related to a normal bell curve shape with the highest in the middle around the mean and decreasing toward both sides equally. So it's nice distributed around the mean. So in our example with the glucose, of normal of 80 to 100, then the mean, the middle, should be 90. And it would be the most people around 90. That would be, if we use that range, then that's just the easiest way. It's the middle. Sorry about that. The Gaussian curve or Gaussian distribution has been shown to be correct for virtually all types of biological, chemical, and physical measurements. And a statistically valid series of individuals who are thought to represent a normal healthy group are measured, and the average value of the measurement is calculated. And so for establishing a reference range for a new test, if it's a brand new test, it will take at a bare minimum at least 700 healthy individuals and run the test on them to get what on average a healthy person will be, and then they'll calculate within those 700, within that data, what two standard deviations above and below the mean are, and that would be your reference range. There are also stats used to compare observations. So these are the groups of paired observations. You have a comparison of methods experiment. So it involves measuring patient specimens by two different methods, an existing or reference method and a new method. Generally, the reference method is plotted on the x-axis and a new method on the y-axis. And so, for example, in this graph, if we took this point here, we could see that the new test method has a reading of 40, but if you go down here, you would see that according to the reference method, the reading was 35. And so you do a series of patients that way, and you run it on the new method and an old method, and you plot those pairs together, and you have to determine the line of best fit, which again can be calculated. It's calculated in via linear regression, and the function of the line is going to be the equation y equals mx plus b with a slope and intercept, etc., in the graph. So this is back to math, right? So that allows you to see if you bring in a new method in, a new analyzer, like how much are your reference ranges going to shift around? If there's perfect correlation between the two, then maybe you don't need to change anything. But if there is a difference between the reference and the new method and you switch into a new method, then you may have to do something like alert all the physicians that have to adjust our reference ranges because we have a new method for measuring whatever test it is. Sometimes also if in a lab there are multiple analyzers that can measure the same thing. So this is very common in chemistry. especially if you have a high volume lab, to have multiple analyzers, and to have one analyzer might be the main one to run all the chemistry testing, and then the other one is considered a backup analyzer, and it's used to maybe run some more unusual or less ordered tests. And but if the first machine goes down, there's trouble, it's broken down, then you have to be able to run those critical results, those critical samples on the other, on the backup analyzer. And these machines should yield the same result whether you run a sample on one or the other. But how do you know unless you do one of these analyses with a linear regression? And you can also, with the data set of the new versus the old, or machine A versus machine B, run a correlation coefficient calculation. And so the correlation coefficient measures the strength of the relationship between the reference method and the test method, or between simply two sets of data. The coefficient of correlation is a measure of the strength of the relationship between two methods. Okay. It can have values from -1 to 1, it's indicated by the little letter R. So a positive R indicates that both variables increase or decrease together, and that is what you'll typically see with new methods, or a new test method, reference method, or machine A, machine B. So they usually tend to increase or decrease together. But a negative R indicates that as one variable increases, the other decreases. Now, when you're looking at data for like health, for example, this could make total sense. For example, you could say, you can analyze two sets, you know, data on number of minutes somebody exercises and their risk of chronic heart disease or chronic disease of some sort. And you could say and predict and see the correlation that as the number of minutes one exercises per week goes up, the risk for chronic disease goes down. And so that would be one where you would expect a negative R. So an R value of 0 indicates no relationship at all. And a value of 1 indicates a perfect relationship, so perfect agreement between the two methods, or perfect agreement between the two analyzers. 0.95 and higher on a coefficient correlation is excellent. Most clinical chemistry method comparisons should have agreements of 0.98 or higher, especially if you're intending on using the same reference ranges. And then we're going to talk about the types of errors. So the difference between the test and the reference method is called the error. And those errors can be random or systematic. So random errors are present in all measurements, and they can be positive or negative, meaning they can be higher than the target value or lower than the target value. Now, what is the target value? The target value for any one sample is its actual concentration of the analyte you are measuring. So if we go back to glucose, if the actual concentration in the sample is 85 milligrams per dL, you want your analyzer to read 85 milligrams per dL. And so random errors could make it like where if you read it once, it's reading, let's say, 85, but you try to read it again and maybe there's a bubble, there's something in there, and it reads something weird like 75. And so random errors cannot be predicted, and they're present in all measurements, and it can cause a reading to be higher or lower than its target value. Systematic errors are going to be consistently in one direction, and they're going to be either above or below the target value, and they're usually due to a problem in the system, problem in the method. So if you have a systematic error, if the target value is 85, it might systematically or consistently be reading 87 to above. And then if your one sample was 80, you'd read 82. Okay, and that systematic error can be constant or proportional. So it could be constantly reading 2 above what it's supposed to, right? And it's always going to be 2 above. Or it could be proportional, meaning that in the lower end of the glucose measurement is reading maybe 2 above, but if you get into values where now we have 200, 300, then maybe at 200 now it's reading 10 above, and you get to 300 it's reading 15 above, and you get to 400 it's reading 20 above, so that the difference increases as the analyte concentration increases. So that would be proportional. Again, systematic errors are usually attributed to the method of measurement, to the analyzer, to something in the system, right? Not something that's random. Okay. So in our next video, we are going to talk about quality control here in more in depth. So I'll see you there.